Hello and welcome back. I'm Max from the marketing department and you're here for another video about lighting. So today I'm going to give you a brief overview of different lighting fixtures. Fixture, anything that emits light and is used on stage or wherever you want to. So I'm gonna give you a brief overview of different types of lamps, fixtures, and trying to give you a glimpse about the different feature sets that different types offer and how to use them. So, but first things first, so that we can see what we do and that there's more effect of lights, we need some fog or haze, whatever. You might have seen that already on stage at a concert. If there's no haze, no fog machine, anything like that, the lights lose a lot of their intensity and impact because you can only see colored spaces and the surfaces of different things that the light shines onto, but you can't see the beams and the rays of light itself. So we're gonna make some fog right now. So different light types, different types of fixtures. You can differentiate, for example, between lights using normal light bulbs, conventional lighting, and lights using LEDs. So regarding conventional lamps, there's the trusted Parken, this thing. And I'm using a Showtech EC16 lighting console, basic lighting desk. That's offering me control over 32 DMX channels. If you want to know more about DMX or if anything is not quite clear about what I'm talking about, maybe head over to a YouTube channel, have a look at the first video that we did where we explained like basic DMX, everything probably I hope you need to know about how to control lights and what DMX is. And yeah, back to topic. Conventional lights, let me try and touch it because it gets warm because it's like a normal conventional light bulb. Silvery, classic look. In earlier days of lighting, stage lighting concerts, you had a shitload of them in the lighting rig on stage. Like, we're not talking 10, 20 or 50 of them, we're talking a few hundred. And as you can imagine, these are conventional lights. They need quite some power. Main difference is conventional lights are basically just a light bulb with a power connector. I can plug that into a normal power socket in my wall and it goes full on. I can put a dimmer in between, which allows me then to control it with values in between. And of course, you can control a dimmer with DMX. So if I want to control my conventional lights with a lighting desk, I need a dimmer in between. And one side note, dimmers can most often be switched between dimmer and Switchpack. Switchpack is just, or switch capability, it's just again on off, as if I would plug it into the wall outlet at home or wherever, but I can remote control it with DMX. So if you need remote control, you probably need a dimmer for your conventional lights. And as I said before, my conventional lights can just be warm, glowing light bulbs, anything like this. Don't have any color by themselves, but obviously there are color filters, color gels, and you can put that in front of the light and you will then have obviously some kind of color. And this is what they look like. This is the basic frame. This is a color gel in this. This one is primary red. Can't remember the Li number, excuse me, but you can look it up. And you can get these in all kind of different color shades. And if I want to have this in red, I can just use the color filter, put it on top. I won't put it into the light right now, into the Parken, just lay it on top so you can see. And obviously I have a second red light and beam of light. By the way, beam of light, good point. Let's make some weird noises and fire up the haze and fog machine again. And yeah, basically, as you can see now, the thing is red. And as you might have also noticed, the light amount that gets out of the Parken right now is less than if I'm using it like that. And that's because all of the filters are subtracting different colors from the light spectrum. White has like all colors in it and it sum together, you get white. That's why you can put any kind of filter in front of that and get a certain color. So the red one cancels out every light except the red wavelength. And that's why you get red light. But it's because of your canceling out the other stuff, you're leaving that out. It won't pass through the filter. That's why you get less light with a filter in front of that. So if you want just basic color, no color changing, or you exactly know what colors you want and they don't need to change, you can just use that. You can use a conventional light and that's it. The great advantage, the white color is really nice, really warm. You need quite a high level of LED fixture to produce a look, a color temperature that gets close to that. And one big advantage for the conventional lights in this case is they are quite cheap. So if I want a LED light that does exactly the same, I probably have to pay 10 times as much for the LED fixture, even more maybe than for the conventional lights. But if you want color changing, want to go something like, hey, I have a different color each song or each bar or each note, whatever you want, do whatever you want. Do circus lighting. I'm not a fan of it, but that's up to you. Of course, LED or some fixture with color mixing is the way to go. And of course, LEDs will draw just a fraction of the amount of power than you need for conventional lights. For example, this we use right now, this RGB fixture that's on right now, it's probably around 60 watts, something like that. And this conventional light here is 300 watts. If I need to use more of these, because I want like 8 beams on stage, I really need to worry about how many power that draws. They will get hot, they will draw bigger amounts of power, and you have to really worry about not overloading the power socket you're using. So of course, that's a great effect if you want to just set a nice mood, not go full on lights all of the stage, and maybe like for an intro, for if you're playing acoustic set or if you're playing an acoustic song, for example. No matter what, if I'm playing a metal show, there's an acoustic song, I want something not as high intensity like my normal metal things, I might use this effect. And as you might see, it gets more orangey, warmer color temperature than with full on. So one last thing about PAR cans, you get different light bulbs for that, and they have different beam angles. So there's, you might have read that already, there's WFL, NSP, VNSP, and that stands for example, narrow spot and very narrow spot, and wide float inside an LED PAR. Normally you have everything built into the fixture, so you just need power and DMX directly at the fixture. When with the conventional lights, you have two parts, a dimmer and the light itself. One really important thing regarding that, if you're using like multi-socket power outlets for the conventional lights, like I'm using here right now, it's really important that you, well, that you don't plug any other things inside this power outlet because it's dimmed. Than the lights you want to dim. Because if your guitarist plugs his amp in there and you're going like not full percent, which would be like 230 volts inside the EU, but you're going like 50% and you're giving it only a fraction of the normal voltage, well, there goes your guitar amp. Your guitarist needs a new one. And in this case, when I'm doing lighting on stage and I'm doing the stage cabling myself, and I'm using multi-power outlets, multi-sockets, like this one. If I don't use them because I need more PAR cans in a row, I'm always taping them so that nobody might plug whatever in there because they need power for their pedal board, amp, sampler, keys, whatever. Just make sure that doesn't happen. That could really ruin your day, your gig. So with conventional lights, you can have different types. For example, a PAR can, simple as this, blinders, or, well, that's ACLs, Google that, aircraft landing. It's just a very narrow spot and you use more of them to make a fan on stage. Google it, you will have seen it, I promise you. So that's the main fixture types you will need to worry about regarding conventional lighting. Back to LED lights. Basically, any conventional light can be replaced with a LED fixture. That's common practice because the LEDs over the years got better and better with color mixing, with color temperature. If you have really high-end LED fixtures, they have different color temperatures that you can set. You can set dimming curves to emulate the curve of a conventional fixture, and even the color temperature change when you use only small values with your dimmer. So with LEDs, you can have color mixing inside the fixture and you can strobe and dim with the fixture itself. So regarding color mixing, I'm going to show you this with two or maybe even three different fixtures because they're different kinds of color mixing. So if you have a look at this LED bar, you can see the 8 red LEDs lighting right now. And if I pull up the fader that controls the blue channel, it will add up and it will get something pink purple. And that's basic color mixing inside LEDs. This is just RGB, red, green, blue. There are different kinds of color mixing. Some LEDs even have like white or amber, which is a yellow or orangey color that might be hard to reproduce with just the RGB mixtures. And some even have UV light. Right here, you can see the different LEDs. You can see, if you have a look at the lamp itself, at the fixture, you can see blue and you can see red. Of course, up here, it's already mixed. You get whatever you want to call that magenta color. But especially in the first like 40 centimeters, you can still make out the different colors. That's a big difference in how the LED lighting is mixed with color mixtures. I will use my moving head wash that I have here on the fader page B, which is this one. So you can see this right now is, hopefully you can see on camera actually, this is pretty whitish. And well, there's a color mixture inside. Let me see what we can get. Okay, now we have the red channel only on. You can see only red, only green, only blue. If I do the same thing as before, I'm mixing the red and blue, you don't see two different LEDs lighting up. That's either because there's LEDs inside with one LED being able to do different colors, or with multiple LEDs but a lens afterwards. So the big lenses in here mix the color if there are multiple LEDs behind that, and you can only see the already mixed color outside, which if you ask me is a much better looking experience. And the next thing that's important, the moving head is not just RGB, it's RGBW, which stands for white. So with this one, if I want white, I can just raise white LEDs, which are a little bit bluish right now. That's something that happens really often until you reach a certain price point. So in this case, if it's a little bit bluish, I can try and correct that. So if it's a little bit bluish, I didn't raise my blue channel, so I can't pull that out anymore. I could raise the red and the green channel. So just the red channel, even better. And with red and green, okay, now we have too much green. I could even simulate something a little bit warmer, like this. Now it has 100% red, like 50% green and 40% white. And if I erase, if I lower the white LED, which is on channel 13 right now, I can make it even warmer until it starts to get really yellowish because there's no white LED in it anymore. So if I want to emulate that with a small bar, it might get really tricky because first you can always see the RGB LEDs themselves, and I don't have a cold white LED that helps me get to a true white. The one next here, which is now lighting up in red. You have a lot of small LEDs. And if I start mixing them, as you can see, the effect of single visible LEDs in different colors is even exaggerated, because it has like 100 LEDs in there, not just 20 or how many there are. And of course, up here, the color is mixed. Down there, you can see a not so nice looking pattern. And especially on the spot where you shine, you might see color fringing at the sides. You might get a colored edge off the spot. And this gets better if you have color mixing behind the lens. And yeah, basically that's it regarding color mixing. One more thing you can do is shutter. So they have an inbuilt, normally electronic shutter that just goes on, off, on, off, on, off, like a strobe. And with this kind, let me see if I find the right channel. Yeah, I found it. If you have an LED fixture that has not only RGB channels or RGB and dimmer, but a strobe channel, you can go metal. Or you can go strobe with country music, whatever. What you do is up to you. If it fits the music, it's a different story. So, shutter, nice effect to raise the intensity even more. And besides that, what we can do with this moving head, what certain other fixtures support, is a zoom. And a zoom is basically a change in the beam angle. So with this moving head, I have a range of, I think, 10 to like 30-ish degree. Right now it's the smallest, which is 10 degree. And let me raise that a little bit to get it even higher, so you maybe can see better. If I raise the fader of that feature, the beam will get from narrow to really broader. Yeah, that's basically the effect. Let's get a little bit more haze in here. So now, I think you can make it out even better. As I said, this is like the smallest beam angle. This is like 10 degree. And if I raise that to full, you can see the beam gets really broad. So one last thing regarding beam angle. This is the beam you see. Of course, after a certain area, you will hit the stage or the audience or the room where you light. So you also have to worry about how big does the spot need to be? How big will the musician be that's inside the spot? That changes with the distance from the light fixture to the surface you hit. Just keep that in mind. If you're shooting video, you might get some flickering of LEDs that aren't visible with your bare eye, but that are visible on screen. So keep in mind, if you're shooting film, if you're doing videos of your live shows or anything like that, you might keep in mind that you check with the camera and record some footage when you buy your lights and see if it's cool or if you see flickering and if you might need to get some other lights, some probably more expensive lights that don't have this problem. This is especially with older or cheaper LEDs. There are certain ways around that problem. You can maybe adjust the shutter speed or your camera. There are possibilities. They might not always work, they can, but we won't have time to get into that today. Also, again, a problem with the entry-level LEDs. The dimming curve might be not so smooth as you are used to with conventional lights. And it's again a problem with older or cheaper LEDs that they might jump from zero to quite some light, but with your fader, you go only the first few percent. This is the red RGB bar that I showed you first. If I put that down and I just really, really slowly move my first fader, it should come up really smooth, but you might see some steps inside the dimming. That's because it's a rather cheap dimmer and a rather cheap LEDs that can't produce such smooth dimming curves. And I think it's quite visible that it jumps in intensity. Especially the lower I get. And yeah, the first 2 millimeters I move with my fader, nothing happens, and then bam, they're on. and this behavior can be more pronounced or less pronounced depending on the fixture. Try that when you buy some stuff. So now you've got a basic glimpse about LED versus conventional lighting and everything you can do with LED lights. And regarding fixture types, well, I've showed you different kind of bars, different kind of spots that you can use. That's one fixture type, either LED or conventional. Then of course we have our moving head. Moving heads are available in all kind of different variations, from beam types with narrow angle to spots with medium beam angle, and you get wash lights with a really broad beam angle. Of course, the one I've got here, because it has zoom, it can do different things, or it falls into more than one category. And with spotlights, spot moving heads especially, you get gobos, you get prisms, whatever, all kind of different stuff that's way too sophisticated to talk about it in just 2 minutes. So then of course we have blinders, which are just really broad lights. This one right here is used to flood the stage with light and with color, and to make a certain mood, a certain color on the whole of the stage. And yeah, with that, I can strobe, as with most LEDs, so I can go metal. And then there are of course LED bars, which I mentioned before, narrow but long. And we have a certain variation of that right here. We have the famous Sunstrip, which is 550 watts of power, so quite high again. I can't use many of that on one power outlet, almost double than this par can. It has warm white light, only that because it's conventional, but I can do different things with that. It has 10 different bulbs, which I, in theory, if my control allows it, I can control each on its own, so I can do funny effects and everything. In this case, I'm using it in a two-channel mode, so I can do up, down, whatever, things like this. And the same again, if I'm using it in really low dimmer values, it gets warmer because it's conventional lights. And yeah, that's basically it. A brief overview over different light types, what you can do with them, conventional lights, LEDs. I hope you found it helpful. If you have any questions, if you have any, well, suggestions for maybe another video, leave that in the comment section below. So follow us on YouTube, subscribe if you liked the video, and until next time, have fun with lighting on stage, and remember, do whatever you want, try things out, and do what works best for you. Take care.